Hey, you're listening to the wrong podcast. Topics today include art, museums, and blockchains.
Wrong! What's wrong with you? What's wrong with y'all?
What's wrong with you?
What's wrong with you people? Wrong!
You do have to tolerate it. It's my show.
Hi, I'm Tim. I'm here to talk about politics, culture, religion, sports, and anything else you're not allowed to talk about in polite company. Issue number one! Jackson! This is a crazy story, but you've got to know about it. There's this former truck driver. She's in a thrift store, and she sees this painting that she just thinks is ugly. It's about, 4 feet by 3 feet, somewhere in there. And she buys it for $5. And she's like, this will be a hilarious prank on my friend. So she buys this painting, goes to her friend's trailer home to give her this painting. And the painting won't fit through the door. So she can't give it to her friend. So she keeps it. Later on, she has a garage sale. And she sets out this painting. And an art teacher walking by looks at the painting and says, this might be a Jackson Pollock. Now, who's Jackson Pollock, you might be saying? Jackson Pollock is a famous modern artist who used a drip paint method. He would, he'd have these huge canvases and he'd just swing paint wildly over it and let the paint splatter wherever it wanted to. And he's famous, so his artwork is expensive. Whether you like it or not, it's expensive. And she has it checked out, and some people are like, yeah, actually, this is a Jackson Pollock. And she gets this art investigator to look at it, and he finds a fingerprint on the back of the canvas that's Jackson Pollock's fingerprint. She even talks to Jackson Pollock's son, and he's like, I think this actually might be one of my dad's lost pieces of art. Like, he might have done it and thrown it out and somebody picked it up. But yeah, like, I don't want to say anything publicly about it because it might hurt my credibility, but I think this is one of my dad's paintings. So Jackson Pollock paintings at the time were selling for like $150 million. And she's like, great, sign me up for that. So she tries to sell the artwork and she says, I don't need $150 million for it, but I'd like $50 million for it. That seems like a reasonable, fair price to me. And nobody will buy it. And the reason nobody will buy this painting is that she didn't have like a certificate of authenticity. She didn't have a record of who she bought it from and who that person bought it from. She just had a painting with his fingerprint on it. And that's not enough for art collectors. They actually need some sort of list of where the painting has been to make sure it's not fake. And somebody, there's this documentary made about it. So that, added some value to the painting at the very least. And somebody offered her $2 million for it. Mind you, she's a retired truck driver living in a mobile home park. $2 million is a lot of money for just about anybody, but particularly her. That would really change her life. And she says, no, I don't want $2 million. I want what's fair for this thing. Somebody else offers her $9 million. The price has just gone up over 4 times. And she says, no, I want $50 million for this painting. So she waits and waits and waits for somebody to buy this painting. And just like 2 years ago, she passes away without selling the painting. But one of her dying wishes to her son was, get what the painting is worth. Issue number two, steroids. So one of my favorite museums in the world is a museum I have yet to go to, but I really need to. It's like a bucket list thing for me. I need to go to the Baseball Hall of Fame Museum. And this museum collects everything that's important to baseball. All kinds of memorabilia, balls that, you know, were used in a no-hitter, bats that hit famous home runs. And in addition, they honor certain players as members of the Hall of Fame. They have a committee. It's made up of baseball writers, and they vote on who is honored as a Hall of Fame baseball player. And there's other people who are also elected into the Hall of Fame, like managers and owners and journalists. You don't have to be a player exclusively, but for the players, there's a specific criteria for getting into the Hall of Fame. And that is, you have to have played, among others, you have to have played Major League Baseball for at least 10 years, and you can't be voted on for at least 5 years until after you retire. And you can be voted on multiple years, but you have to get like 70% of the vote or 75% of the vote. And you have 10 years in which people can vote on you. And if you don't make it in those 10 years, sorry, you're not in the Hall of Fame. Now, there is another committee where they elect people who might have been overlooked. It's called the Veterans Committee. But really, you want to be voted in those 10 years, in that 10-year period. Now, there's two stipulations to this as people vote. One is that they can't vote for more than 10 players at a time. So there might be 20 guys who are legit Hall of Fame players, but the voters only get to choose 10. And there's this thing, one of the criteria, in addition to having played for, you know, Major League Baseball for 10 years, there's something called the character clause. It's very loose. It just says, hey, you have to be somebody with high character. Now, there are a number of baseball players who this year are meeting the final year of their 10-year eligibility. Players like Barry Bonds, Roger Clemens, and Curt Schilling. This is their last year. If they don't get voted in, maybe someday in the future with the Veterans Committee, but this is their last year of eligibility. And Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens are being exempted. They are for sure two of the best baseball players in baseball history. There's no doubt about it. Roger Clemens just dominated as a pitcher, and Barry Bonds has the record for the most home runs in a season and the most home runs hit in a career. The reason these two men are being excluded is because there is strong evidence that they use steroids while playing. And because of the character clause, people are like, hey, that's cheating. They can't get into the Hall of Fame. Sorry, cheaters don't get in. Curt Schilling has been excluded because he encouraged people to vote for Donald Trump for president. I'm not making that up. Baseball journalists are very liberal, and they do not like Curt Schilling's politics, and they are punishing him for that. Now, he's not the same kind of pitcher Roger Clemens was. He's a bubble player. But I would vote for him if I had a vote. I think he's good enough. Many people say, yeah, I like him. I think he, as a baseball player, he's good enough, but I just really don't like his politics. Which is just weird. And not what I'm here to talk about, but I want you to know at least that side of the story, how this character clause is being used. So people are like, hey, baseball players who use steroids should not be in the Hall of Fame. Therefore, Barry Bonds, Roger Clemens, among others, they don't get in. Problem is, there's a number of players who use steroids who are in the Hall of Fame. Mike Piazza, the same kind of evidence against the other guys, that evidence is out there against Mike Piazza. He was recently voted in. There's others. In addition, steroids isn't the only way players have cheated. There's several players who were known for throwing spitballs, manipulating the ball, you know, putting Vaseline on the ball so it would curve in a special way, or it would act like a wiffle, you know, a wiffle ball instead of a baseball. There's also players who are well known for sign stealing. This is all cheating. They're in the Hall of Fame. In addition, using steroids was not against the rules at the time Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens were using them. Now, this sounds ludicrous to you. It was against the law. They were not allowed to do it in the country, but according to baseball rules, it's fine. And a huge number of players were using steroids. They weren't isolated in their use. And probably over 50% of players were using at the time. So they were on a level playing field. They certainly had advantages over some players, but not all players. So if I were voting, I would vote for Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens. This makes sense to me. There's other players like Manny Ramirez who continue to use steroids after they became illegal. That's a different issue for me. I can for sure see a strong argument against putting them in because they actually violated the rules. But like I said, there's players who we know violated the rules, and it was well known that they were violating the rules, who are also in the Hall of Fame. This gets people really hot and bothered, and I've decided I'm not going to get hot and bothered about it because there's bigger things in the world. The story of baseball will always be told with Barry Bonds in it, whether or not he's honored by the Hall of Fame. He is an important part of the story of baseball, and his name is in the museum. It's just not honored in the museum. But those votes are coming up, and it'll be really interesting to see what journalists will do in this last year. Now, there's one other thing I need to throw in about this character clause. The Baseball Hall of Fame is not owned by Major League Baseball. It's a unique, separate nonprofit organization, but it was established by Major League Baseball. And the commissioner at the time, his name was Kennesaw Mountain Landis. Great name, right? Kennesaw Mountain Landis. And he said, he's the one who came up with this character clause for eligibility into the Hall of Fame. Landis is the guy who said black people shouldn't be allowed to play in Major League Baseball. He was not just a racist. He wasn't just a bigot. He was an overt racist. Like, he went out of his way to discriminate against people because of the color of their skin. He fails the character clause, I would hope. Yet, his name is on the most valuable player trophy that's handed out every year to the best player in baseball. Remember, I want to know what's wrong with you.
What's wrong with you?
If you'd like to submit a question, topic, or tell me how I was wrong, you can email me at listen@thewrongpodcast.com or submit a comment at my website, thewrongpodcast.com. And help me spread the wrong message. If you like what you hear, share it with your friends. Now it's time for my favorite part of the show. I was wrong.
I was wrong. I was wrong.
In episode 49, I was making an argument against abortion, and I played a video that my wife Wendy and I made arguing that people who are living human persons should be protected. And afterwards, I said, if I could make that video again, I would leave out that personhood argument. I would just say, if you're a living human, you should have the right to life. And the reason I said that is because personhood is this squishy term, and philosophy nerds love it because it's full of ambiguity, and ambiguity leaves open the room for possibilities. Well, that comment really frustrated listener John. John is a philosophy professor, so he's thought about philosophy a little bit, and I think he would gladly accept the term philosophy nerd. And he pointed out that the term human is a term of biology, where person is a term of philosophy. And fair enough. That's a good point. Now, I'm going to say some other things he went on to say, and I want to be clear and give John the benefit of the doubt and charity, because he's making his comments on Facebook, and I'm then picking and choosing which comments to tell you about. So some of this might sound kind of out there for you, but please give John the benefit of the doubt. If he could sit down and talk to you about it, I hope, at least, he can make some of it sound at least somewhat reasonable to you. So he was saying that cats, felines, you know, your household cat, they aspire, and therefore they could be called persons. He then went on to say, I don't know how humans achieve personhood. What I do know is that most of the humans I encounter appear to meet enough of the criteria for personhood that I should be cautious and thoughtful about my ethical obligations to them. And I absolutely agree. If you're not sure which living humans are persons, then you should be cautious and thoughtful about your obligations to them. And that's another reason, I think, why we should avoid aborting fetuses. Issue number 3! Non-fungible! Now, in episode 42, I got a lot of positive feedback because I talked about what the word fungible means. And short synopsis, fungible means that something can be used for multiple purposes. Money, in particular, is fungible. Well, there's this thing called non-fungible tokens. You might have heard of them. NFTs. Everybody's selling NFTs. Hey, you know, artists are saying, I've got all these NFTs. Come buy my NFTs. What the heck is an NFT? The most famous case of an NFT selling is somebody bought an NFT for Charlie Bit My Finger. This is a viral video. You've probably seen it, where a little boy is playing with his little baby brother, and the baby brother bites his finger.
No, Charlie bit me. And that really hurt, Charlie, and it's still hurting.
So somebody sold this original video for $700,000. And they're also buying other memes. You know, there's lots of memes of funny people, you know, Bad News Brian or you know, Bad Luck Karen. I don't know. Jerky Jeremy. I'm making that one up. There's all kinds of memes that where people are famous for representing some sort of, you know, human emotion. And people have started selling these images for hundreds of thousands of dollars. And NFTs are selling for millions of dollars in some cases. I was just looking at a bunch of NFTs of monkeys. It's kind of the same monkey drawn in a different costume over and over again. And they were selling for $1,100. Now, what the heck is an NFT and why would I buy one? Well, remember, I told you that story about Jackson Pollock, about this chain of custody that art dealers need to feel confident that they're buying the real thing, that they're not buying a counterfeit. And an NFT is this technology, it's on the web, where you make a record, and then other people copy that record. And if I try to make changes to my original record, well, it's all in this blockchain. That record is in something called a blockchain. And if my changes to my original record aren't there in other people's copy, then you know that something has gone wrong, that I've made a change that I shouldn't have made. I did something bogus. And we trust what everybody else says that, you know, the date of creation was or whatever might be in that ledger. So it's this technology and it's being used to create, you know, these decentralized currencies like Bitcoin, and it's also being used to register art, to say, hey, this piece of art belongs to this person now. I created it, but I sold it to this guy, and now here's a digital record of it that I can't manipulate and nobody else can either. And you're like, great, okay, so, but still, why would you spend $700,000 on a video that you can watch for free on YouTube and it's been duplicated millions of times? You can find this video all over the place. Why in the world would you spend that amount of money on this video or this image that's readily available? It's a digital file. Everybody's got a picture of Bad News Brian on their computer somewhere. It's easy to get to. Why would you spend that money? Well, let's go and look at the Mona Lisa. The Mona Lisa is easily the most famous painting in the world. And its current value is about $860 million plus. It's going up all the time. If you want to buy it from the Louvre, it's going to cost you almost $900 million. Now, you can walk outside the Louvre and there's guys on the street selling replica Mona Lisas. They're the same size. They look identical. These artists are incredible. They're equal in skill to Leonardo da Vinci. They might surpass him even. Why would you buy the really expensive Mona Lisa instead of one on the street that looks exactly the same? Well, it's prestige. You get to say you have the original. And you're not buying it because of the way it looks necessarily. You're buying it because of its historical value. Those other ones on the street, they don't have any historical value. They're knockoffs. You didn't buy it just because it's pretty. It might be pretty, but you're buying it because it's famous, and this is the first one. So that's the thing with NFTs. It's about prestige. Somebody's bought this JPEG image that everybody else has on their computers, but he's got the one that the original artist, that the original person says, this is the first. And I don't even know if it necessarily is the first. It's just assigned that value. It's been assigned the credibility. Somebody's saying, yes, this is the official version. And so, if you're looking to buy NFTs, I would not encourage it unless you have a lot of money and you want to spend that money on prestigious things. You know, there was this app I heard about in the Apple iTunes store, and it was called Bling or something like that. And it costs like, I don't know, $500 to $1,000. And all it would do is you install it on your phone and then you click open and the word Bling would flash in gold letters. Why would you buy that? That doesn't do anything. You buy it to show to your friends that you've got enough money to buy that app, that you don't care about $500, that you'll spend it on something silly like the word Bling flashing on and off on your screen. Well, that's kind of the idea of art collecting. Hey, I've got so much money that I'm going to spend it on something that I think is prestigious to own. And someday, maybe somebody else will be like, yes, that is prestigious. I want to buy it from you. So again, if you've got the money, go nuts. Go buy some NFTs. In fact, maybe I'll start selling you some. You could buy the NFT of this episode if you want. But I don't think it's a great idea. Unless you've got the money. But I could be wrong. If you think I am, let me know. And let me know why. I had fun and I hope you did too. Buh-bye.